No, we'll just, yeah, we can actually shut that one off. That would be interesting to see if this connects.
Now the one tomorrow you have it set for exactly at noon to start.
This one's long.
Oh, is it?
Yes, it would be.
Okay.
Oh, I did it. It's not mine.
Oh, I got it. I'll check your thing.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, I didn't know if I was going to have to open up YouTube on the laptop and start it up and then go back into my presentation.
Oh, right, right.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, I came down before 4, so you can make a bank deposit. And then I wanted to over here run through my program for your eyes. Watch. Better. I bet it feels better too.
It's exactly the same. It doesn't make it
water. It looks like see just a little.
Yeah.
Little dark spot on the bottom side.
Sure.
Did Becca get her horse taken care of?
It was not Becca, it was Beck. Beck had been there since 6:30.
Oh, okay.
And she had to leave to go pick up her kids from school.
Oh, okay.
Beck still wasn't
well,
there.
Well, I didn't hear everything that you were saying. I was having trouble. I had chaos going on in here. So all I heard was that I needed to find somebody to fill in for you. So.
Yeah.
I caught the important stuff. I didn't catch all of it.
Yeah. Becca came. When was it? Yesterday. That was late again.
Yeah.
And.
Thank you. Well, why am I not seeing? I'm not seeing. Oh, so my event in 5 minutes.
Oh, I guess I'm special.
Are you logged into your, into the account?
So how did the...
Chase, yeah.
Yeah.
See better the closer you are.
Yeah.
Right, right.
Although I was logging on to the old one, so I don't know.
Oh.
Who knows? Yeah, see if it works.
Oh, no, not, not, see, now I got it.
But between taking care of Richard, taking care of Patty Lane, working at the hotel, and they started teaching me to do the hotel, behind the, you know, the coffee shop and the little desk, checking the room, taking orders and stuff. Yeah, well, I feel like I have way too many jobs.
You do.
And then
it's trying to sort yourself out.
You do. You just don't quit mine, okay? Speaking of which, oh, I've been texting a little bit with Laura. She didn't know she's in the hospital.
Okay. Yes, I'm going to join.
It might be. Is that long term? I'm going to go and visit her tomorrow after history training.
Well, that's interesting thing.
Yeah, the bus brought me out to the hospital instead of home, so. I just want to know where if I go and actually visit her, we talk. She can actually let me know what's going on.
Well, right at by the side of the road. I just heard
it's
about that.
Supposed to be
and it isn't.
I couldn't.
Yeah, you would. Anyway.
Yeah, because.
Yeah. Bummer, no.
Yeah, that weekend that. Not this weekend, but next weekend she's supposed to be gone.
I read one of his books.
You're
very interesting.
On the 30th, right?
And I listened to another one about
My progress.
What
it's
about?
That
and it was
off.
All terrible.
Yeah, so
all, you know, horrible stories.
He does.
So statistics.
She was supposed to work this morning.
Yeah, I'm not fond of statistics, but he comes up
to
see
the morning of
most interesting.
Morning of 30th.
Right. So we'll have to see how it. I'll go. I'll find out more tomorrow.
Should be being one of the booker.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, it's about Scotland, that's.
You're going to see
that.
That
was
right.
Yeah,
actually. Oh, yeah.
Oh, because you're really sure.
Yeah.
No, if that's the case, you have to look disinterested and stare at your phone
the
whole
time. Yeah, I'm sure you have plenty of those, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. Especially the last couple of years. That was.
Oh, I bet so.
Okay.
You didn't think everybody checked their phone till the door?
No.
You weren't quite to that point?
No.
Anyway, what I was thinking of.
I feel like. You're grown up.
Well, and that's, I was just thinking the same thing. Yeah, you can either keep it or be disinterested and you'll give her
like
a copy of your ass or an apple. Yeah, well.
Oh, like
oh,
sugar.
I think though, if I would say it, not sugar, maybe my parents. I'd have my kids check it.
Well, most schools don't allow them to
have a
singing class.
Right.
In fact, I was talking to the Edgemont music teacher, remember, and their policy was you have to leave your cell phone and your wallet so you can check it.
Oh, classes. There you go, yeah.
But if you were caught with it in class, it was confiscated, and you didn't get it back to the
university. Oh, wow.
What's your bottom book?
Second day of school. Principal, sorry.
Oh, I haven't read that. Oh, I just have to.
A week later,
yeah, it is.
Kids caught with a new phone.
Oh no!
Only good water too.
That's principal powder, huh?
Yep, of course.
Right. St. Levy, I think.
Well, I'm trying to fix some of the glare on the screen because it gets kind of rough. But without turning the lights all the way out, you can't really get rid of everything. Okay.
And that affects how
you work.
All right.
We'll sit in the dark and have light.
All right. Well, welcome everybody. My name is Chris Hahn. I'm the director here. I think you know most of you guys, so that's good. This month for Music Speaks, we're talking about music in the brain, and a little bit about how we hear, how music affects us, possibly some medical health benefits from listening to music, just a little bit about what they're doing with dementia research in music, and how all that's happening. So the stuff that was just playing in the background, what did you think? Did you really notice it, or was it just
soothing?
Soothing, yeah. Music like that is designed essentially to be as non-confrontational as you can get. That's actually a playlist that was called, I think, Music for Study or something. I don't know what it was called. But anyway, it's just basically somebody sitting down kind of noodling and not just doing it. Anyway, it's supposed to be pleasing, nondescript, and vanilla, you know, not like vanilla with little bits of beans in it, but like plain old boring vanilla. And now compare that with something like this. So, what emotions or ideas does that conjure up?
A threat. The Klingons are coming.
Perhaps, yeah.
Darth Vader has shown up.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. That idea. It's actually Holst from the planets. That's Mars, the bringer of war. But that just the sound of it, and there are other things about it: timbres, pitches, all that stuff. Give you a certain emotion. Compare that to this, though. So, now what does that do for you?
Church, I guess. Yeah. Praise music from church.
Yeah. Yeah. In the Everlasting Arms is the piece. Yeah. Does anybody know what that's from? That particular recording of it? Was from the remake of True Grit. Yeah. The original had John Wayne. The remake had Jeff Bridges as Rooster Cogburn. Mm-hmm. And that's actually one of the main themes of the whole movie, which if you think about it, in the Everlasting Arms, and of course the lead female loses her arm at the end of it, there's a little bit of irony there, but it works really well in the context of the film, because Rooster Cogburn literally carries her in his arms to save her life at the end of the movie. And but yeah, a whole different set of emotions and thoughts and ideas. Whether you like or don't like the music, it's not really what we're talking about here. We're just talking about how it has an effect on us. So, we all hear music the same way, physiologically. We respond to it in general the same way, but with some differences. And think about this, you know, which is more likely going to get an emotional reaction out of you? Listening to an orchestra or reading an owner's manual.
Definitely. Probably
the orchestra. Although I will say that if it's your first new dryer in like 30 years,
you may get a little choked up reading it and excited. So, I'll give you that. But the way our brain connects to sound is just an amazing thing. So why does music do that? What is it about music that makes us feel things? Probably hard to read this, but when you listen to music, it'll release dopamine, which is a chemical that helps you to feel good. Music with a strong beat stimulates brain waves. Music with a weak beat tends to calm us down. So you can actually change the activity of your brain by different types of music being played. It can be used to reduce your perception of pain. We'll talk about that in a little bit. It can change your state of mind. It can alter your breathing and your health rate. And it can distract you from other things. It can do all these interesting things. And how it does all that stuff, we're still learning about. We're still figuring out. The idea of the study of neuropsychology, like how our brain actually works, relatively new, and they're making a lot of advancements now, because now we have MRIs and PET scans and all this technology, and they have portable MRIs, so you can measure people's brain activity in different ways than we were able to in the past. So when we listen to music, some of the things that can happen: the pupils in our eyes dilate, our pulse and blood pressure can go up or down, the conductivity of our skin changes. All these different things happen physiologically. And the cerebellum, which down in kind of this part of your brain that works with the motor part of our body, bodily movement and all that, when you listen to music, the cerebellum actually activates and sends blood to your legs, more blood than usually flows. Some people say that's why we tap our toes when we listen to music, is because they increase blood flow. It's a theory, and I'm sure somebody's studying it. How they're going to figure that out, I'm not quite sure. But so we respond to stuff differently. So what, right? Who cares? We listen to it, it makes us feel. Isn't that enough? Well, yes and no. I think this quote has been applied to a lot of different people. It's one of those things that, Einstein said it, Louis Armstrong said it, who knows, Ronald Reagan, who knows who said it. But it'll get passed around that way. But the science, the stuff we're going to look at today, kind of finds answers, but the questions are so much more important, I think, in a way, because you don't know what you don't know until you find out, right? And art is really good at making us think about things we don't know. And so, for example, some of the things we can find out: cognitive development in kids. Kids are born innately musical, and we'll see a little video clip that shows that here in a minute. By the age of 8, if kids don't have musical training or a musical outlet, that goes away. Eight seems to be about, and part of that is because, when we're born, all of our neural pathways are sort of interconnected. And some child psychologist said, basically babies see the world as if they're on LSD, because they're just this massive trip. As we get older, those pathways get truncated into the way they are as an adult brain. And that continues for a while. And so if those pathways aren't being exercised or being used, then they just go away. And that's how our brain figures out how to kind of mold itself into what a human brain typically does. So yeah, if that stuff isn't happening, it tends to go away. One of the other things we can talk about is advocating for the arts. And as a musician, of course, this is a big deal for me. As artists, it's a big deal. As writers, poets, you want to advocate for it because, the arts are where we kind of deal with what's going on in our lives and in the world, and whatever medium we use, that's how we think about things, that's how we express things. And if that goes away, then thinking about kids again, they have no outlet.
So the more, whether it's sports, whether it's music, whether it's art, it doesn't matter. They need an outlet of some kind. And so advocating for that is worthwhile. And one of the, you know, and one of the things about the arts as opposed to sports, not to sound like I'm anti-sports, you know, go Dodgers. I'm so disappointed. The arts are something that everybody can do. And a great example of that is you get kids playing instruments in band. They graduate high school, they quit playing until they have kids in a career and they retire and they have some time and then they join a community band. You know, I direct the Northern Hills Band and it's the average age of that band, if take away a couple of people, and it's about probably 65, maybe 70. You don't get that middle range, but it's something that people come back to. How many 70-year-olds are playing football? But you can't. You know.
Not very many 20-year-olds are playing.
Well, true. You know, so it's not, and pitting one against the other, it just isn't worthwhile. It just doesn't make, because everybody has different outlets. But the arts can be a really a great way for that. And then we'll talk about medical and health benefits here in a minute. Okay, so I've got this kind of stupid little video about how the brain how the ears work, I should say. And this will be, most of you guys I'm sure know this stuff, but it's kind of a nice refresher to think about what's actually going on. So before we start this, what is sound?
Vibration.
Yeah, it's actually compression of whatever medium you happen to be in. If you're underwater, it's water. When you're out of the water, it's air. So I make noise that's causing changes in pressure. Those changes in pressure enter our ears, and then this is what happens. And the fact that it was a trumpet on this
is just how sounds that make their way from the source all the way to your brain. Take a trumpet, for instance. When it's played, it makes sound waves in the air. The outer ear catches the waves, which then travel through a narrow passageway called the ear canal. The sound waves reach the eardrum, which is a membrane roughly half the size of a dime. They make the eardrum vibrate, which in turn vibrates three tiny bones called the malleus, incus, and stapes. These bones amplify or increase the sound vibrations and send them to the cochlea. The cochlea is shaped like a snail and is the size of a garden pea. It is filled with fluid, and the sound vibrations make this fluid ripple, which creates waves. Hair-like structures called stereocilia sit on top of hair cells and are grouped together as hair cell bundles inside the cochlea. The hair cells inside the cochlea ride these waves, and the hair bundles are moved. The hair bundle on top of the hair cell turns these movements into electrical signals. As the hair bundles are moved, ions rush into the top of the hair cells, causing the release of chemicals at the bottom of the hair cells. The chemicals bind to the auditory nerve cells and create an electrical signal, which travels along the auditory nerve to the brain. Different hair cells respond to different frequencies of sound. The hair cells at the base of the cochlea detect higher pitched sounds, such as a piccolo or flute. The hair cells toward the top of the spiral detect progressively lower pitched sounds, such as a trumpet or trombone. At the very top or apex of the spiral, the hair cells detect the lowest pitched sounds, such as a tuba. The auditory nerve carries the electrical signal to the brain, which interprets the messages as sounds that we recognize and understand.
Every time I watch that, it just blows me out. It's like, that's amazing. That's just amazing that that happens. Now, in addition to the cochlea, we have these semicircular canals up here that are connected to the vestibular nerve. That's actually involved in balance. And so not only is the ear acting as a way to hear what's going on around us, it also affects our balance. That's why, you know, when you're congested, you can't hear very well, and if you have fluid issues, your balance may go as well, or if your hearing is affected, you know, your balance is affected as well. So the vestibular nerve comes down here to the pons and the base of our brain, and sometimes it's called the reptilian part, you know, the oldest part of the brain. And then the cochlear nerve actually goes to the thalamus and the auditory cortex, which is kind of here. And that's where, so that's where it starts. And that's just sending this electrical signal that our brain converts to sound. Now, after that, then all sorts of interesting things happen. One of the depressing things about hearing is that when you're about 20 or so, that's as good as your hearing will ever be as far as frequency range. Over time, it just naturally starts to go down. Now, you can't really do anything to stop that, but you can do lots of things to accelerate that. If you're working in a loud environment, if you're around lots of loud noises, without hearing protection, if you're wearing headphones cranked up to 11, you're going to damage those cells, those hair cells in your ear. And the thing about them is they don't regenerate. Once they're gone, period, end of story, at least with current science. And that's why if you've ever been to a really loud concert, you walk out of the concert, you're talking like this to everybody, because what happens in that case is your brain does have kind of a built-in muting system. So if you're around really loud noises, there are little muscles inside the cochlea that keep those hair fibers from moving. It just kind of clamps it down so they're not being kind of jolted by the sound. But that makes everything softer. And so that's why you talk louder, is because your ears aren't working as well. Over time, that comes back a little bit, unless you're really doing damage. But anyway, what we're going to do now is a little test to see how old your ears are. And if you've been to an audiologist, you've probably done this type of thing. There's going to be a really high pitch, and it's going to start to get lower and lower, and there are numbers up on the screen. When you can hear that sound, raise your hand, look at the number. That's how old your ears are. So hopefully this won't be too loud, but here we go. Ready? Oops. That went too many times.
There it is.
So, yeah, so it goes to 100. So, do you guys want to do it?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. We'll do it one more time for them. All right. And it's making noise. We can't hear it. Mystery probably can. No?
No, I can't hear it.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just going too fast.
Well, no, that's, and so if that number is equal to your age, great, good for you. Mine's actually low. I will say that part of that is based on volume, because if I have it turned up higher, I was telling Sierra, if I have it turned up higher, I can hear it at a younger age. But if I have the sound turned down, then I'm more at my actual age. It's not scientific, although it's based in that. Anyway, so our ears just get old over time. So we got the sound coming into our brain. Our brain is processing pitch, timbre, which is the specific quality of the sound, like a trumpet versus a drum. There's a temporal aspect of it, what we think of as rhythm. All those things are being processed inside, in the temporal lobe, where the auditory cortex is. From there, though, it goes lots of places, and this is the amazing thing about sound. We already talked about it goes here, but it also goes down here with balance, coordination, movement, So those two are activated at the very beginning, but then it actually spreads every place else. So you look at this, the brain at rest, and this is from the top looking down. You have a few hot spots. The redder it is, the more activity is going on. But then you put on music, and all of a sudden the whole brain is lighting up. And this is actually cross sections as you go from the top of the brain down, and as you get down there into the middle of the brain, you've got all these hot spots that fire up. Even lower, this would be down at the cerebellum, the motor cortex, all of that. So it's not just working the auditory cortex, it's working everything. And that's where things really kind of get interesting, is how do we take all these individual sounds and make something out of them? Not only speech, but music as well. And basically what our brain does is this. It takes all those pieces, all those individual pitches and rhythms, and it puts it together in something that makes sense. Just like this triangle right here that you probably can see. There is no triangle there, but we see one, right? Our brain, feature extraction is what it's called. Now, somebody may look at this and go, well, there's three Pac-Men and some points. But our brain looks at that and goes, oh, well, yeah, but we can put that together and we can see this. That's something that seems to be unique to humans, as far as we can tell. Responding to music seems to be unique to humans. There's a question about birds. Now, birds tweeting and singing, that's communication, that's not music. But there are some birds that seem maybe to respond to musical stimulus, but it's only about 20% of the time, and they can't replicate it. So the jury's still kind of out on that one. But anyway, so here's an aural example of what our brain's doing. This piece by Chopin, great piano piece. Chopin was writing music in the late 1800s. And this is slowed way, 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 way down so that we can actually hear the individual notes. Going on, and actually two kind of different rhythmic things going on. There was the left hand of the piano was playing kind of sets of four notes, and the right hand, the higher pitches, were actually playing sixes on top of that. So there's this weird thing going on. But what our brain does is it takes all those individual things, and when you listen to it up to tempo, and it's this part that we'll hear right here. Is hearing all those individual notes, but it's putting them together just like we do with sounds and words and phrases and sentences and paragraphs. It's doing the same thing musically. So we're hearing a musical line. Our brain is taking those individual ideas and putting them together to create something that's not just notes. What's happening is Broca's area and Wernicke's area, which deal with language and comprehension, they start to light up when we hear music, as well as motor cortex. We already talked about that. That's why you move when you listen. But what we found is that if you're listening to music that, for lack of a better term, makes sense, these areas light up. But if you're listening to music that doesn't make sense, it lights up even more. So if the music's not following the rules, our brain is working harder to figure out what's happening. So why does it do that? Well, what happens if say you're learning how to speak French, and you're at the beginning stages, and somebody comes and they start speaking French to you, you're like, slow down and let me really listen. Okay, I can figure it out. So you're working hard to understand it. The more fluent you get, the less you have to work at it, right? If you listen to somebody who can speak more than one language, they just flip back and forth between languages and it just works. So they don't have to work as hard because the brain understands patterns. And once it figures out that pattern, then it's like, oh, I know what's happening. And it doesn't have to work as hard to figure out what's going on. So that musical grammar, for lack of a better term, allows us, I think it kind of has a little bit to do with why we like some things and why we don't like things. You know, people don't like change, right? I like what I like. You play new music for them. This happens in orchestras all the time. You play new music for them. I don't like that. Why not? I just don't like it. Can you give me a reason? I just don't like it. Okay, listen to it a few times. They still may not like it, or they may go, oh, well, usually they go, oh, well, that's not so bad. I'm still not crazy about it, but that's not so bad. Our brain is figuring out the patterns. It's learning the grammar and the context of what's happening. Part of that is just innate. There are certain sounds, and we'll talk about this in a second, that cause us to have sudden reactions. That's just in us, it's in our DNA. Mainly fight or flight type of stuff. The other part of it is cultural rules. So if you grow up listening to orchestral music, not only do you know what Western European music sounds like, because that's where this came from, but you also have learned a set of rules on what to do while you're listening to the music, right? You sit quietly. You don't clap in between movements. There are all these things that you don't do. You might not understand what it's like to be around African drumming because you don't have any context to put that in. You might not understand jazz. The rules of being at a rock or a country concert are different. And so culturally, that has an effect as well. There's a great story about a Chinese folk musician who never heard Western music. He was brought to the United States. This was, I think, in the 1970s. And he did a tour playing indigenous Chinese music, and one of his hosts took him to an orchestra concert as a way to say, well, here, this is what we listen to. And so he listened to it, and afterwards, this musician's host was like, well, they were talking about the concert. Well, what'd you think of it? Oh, well, yeah, it was interesting. Well, what was your favorite part? Oh, the first thing they did. Oh, that first piece they played? No, before that. Like before the conductor came out, what they did. I love that. Well, even before the tuning, although there's a joke that, tuning is a Chinese folk song. But before that, often in orchestras, musicians will be on stage and they're getting their instruments warmed up and making sure they're in tune and maybe going over some difficult spots just to get the flow. That part of it, and it's all just random and chaotic, that's what he liked the best. He didn't have any frame of reference, but to him, that was the most interesting part of the concert. We don't even think of that as music. That's noise, people warming up, you don't pay attention. But to him, he had a different set of cultural rules, and he liked that. So that's part of it as well. So let me give you some examples of music that makes sense to us and that maybe doesn't make sense to us as much. The first one, and so when we think of conjunct music, in this case, we're thinking of smooth lines, not a lot of leaps and jumps in the melody. The harmony, what's underneath, is relatively normal, which is a horrible word, but kind of stable. There aren't any real surprises. And this part of Ode to Joy is what we know this as, but this is a great example of that. And you can even see it graphically. It's very smooth. There are a few jumps, but for the most part, it's kind of wave-like. It doesn't do anything really unusual. usual. So anybody with what I would say have Western ears, and by that I mean the Western European tradition that most of us know, this makes perfect sense. Whether you like it or not doesn't matter, it makes sense to us. Now, if you compare that to this, which is a piece that was written early 1900s, this one would be very disjunct. This is a piece of orchestra music, same instruments, but very disjunct in melody, in rhythm, and in harmony. Know what's going on, most people are going to go, well, that's not in my wheelhouse. I've never heard that before. That just sounds like random notes to me. I don't get it. You don't understand the context. Now, with some music, even if you understand the context, you still may go, oh, yeah, that's not very good. But quality is a whole different issue. So if you know the rules, that makes a lot more sense. And when I was younger, I would listen to stuff like that and be like, what is that? Over time, as you listen to it more, now I listen to that when I was putting this together, and I was like, well, that's not a very out there example. And then I had to step back and go, well, yeah, it kind of is, if you're not used to it. So, rules. Now, here's an example of a very disjunct melody and rhythm, but it's within the kind of normal parameters of music that we understand. So now you get into kind of interesting rhythms, and that can you know, change how you think about things too. Some of our expectations, it's easier for us to understand. That's all the front part of our brain, you know, Broca's, Wernicke's area, all that is taking what's happening in the auditory cortex, and it's taking those signals that go everywhere else in the brain and then making sense of it. And then that in turn has an effect on lots of things, not only on our like I talked about pulse and dopamine, and so we're getting kind of interested in that way. So we have a reward essentially when we listen to music that we like. And so what happens is it's actually the anticipation that releases the dopamine. So if you're listening to a piece of music and you can kind of tell where it's going, and you know, oh, it's going to go to this great place, your body starts releasing dopamine during the anticipation. About 10 to 15 seconds is what it takes for that to be released.
You mean even just watching the people at the piano and the violin and the cello or whatever it was up there would be that anticipation?
It's happening orally. I mean, it can happen visually as well. But aurally is a big way that happens.
That might be an expectation visually. Oh yes, this is going to be something I can understand.
Right. And that's how our brain processes this stuff. So the thing is though is you know, you get a dopamine hit, but then after time, that's not as, it doesn't provide the same response as it does, say, maybe the first few times you listen to something. So then you start to think about, well, what about music that I've been listening to for 20 or 30 years? Do I like it as much now as I did then? And in some cases,
Yeah. In some cases, there's probably a lot of music that you liked at one point that now you're like, eh. Mm-hmm. And so one of the possible reasons for that is because you're not getting the same level of dopamine, because even though your brain knows what's coming, it's not as big a release of dopamine because it's so familiar with what's coming, is at least one of the theories they have about it. Yeah.
What about sung music with words?
Well, same thing. And I haven't talked about music a lot, or about words a lot, but you know, Broca's, which, since that's involved with speech, that part is lighting up as you're listening to lyrics. And actually, we'll talk about that. We're going to talk about that here in just a second, because that's a whole another aspect to what's going on musically. So here's an example of you not getting what you expect, or even more so, the composer messing with your expectations, because that's really what's happening with good composers, is they know all this stuff, whether they just do it innately or they kind of learned it over time. They know how to manipulate us, and that's what they're doing musically, is manipulating us through rhythm and through pitch and all the aspects of music. So this first example, what happens, this is a piece by The Police, and you get an introduction, and then all of a sudden you're going to hear these chords going bop, 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 that normally would fall on the beat. But in this case, they're actually bop, 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 bop. They're all on the upbeats, in between the beats, but there's no real strong beat. So as you listen to it, those upbeats become the beat in our ears. We hear bop, 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 instead of bop, 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 bop. But then, and that's through the verse, you get to the chorus and that flips around. And then all of a sudden the downbeat's there. So there's this little hiccup that happens. And this is something The Police did all the time. The drummer talks about it all the time. Stuart Copeland talks about how he would do these things on the drum set. He would leave out a beat that's normally accented, or he would accent something just a little bit ahead of time to give it kind of a boost. So that's what we get here. So that thump, those are the upbeats, even though they sound like downbeats. And you can hear it when the singing happens, then the vocals are seem off. All the vocals, even though the vocals are on the downbeat. And then it flips around. Now, they were really good at it, so that you're not necessarily aware of that, but it's just one of those things that makes the music more interesting. Since it doesn't conform to our normal expectations, our brain's working a little bit harder, we're getting a little more dopamine. Oh, that's great. They were a really popular group. Now, the other thing that can happen is talking about that resolution. Queen does this in Somebody to Love. This is a graph of the song. And you can see there's an introduction, and then it's kind of big for a while, and then you get to 3 minutes, and it drops down to nothing. And then if you look over time, you get all the way up here to 3 minutes and 45 seconds, and you finally get to something big, you finally get that thing, and then it drops down again to just Freddie Mercury singing, and then it's not until here, right about 4 minutes, that you get, oh, okay, this is all resolved. So it's this big, long build. And instead of it taking, you know, 10 or 15 or 20 seconds, they take a minute to do it. So, and they do it by adding pitches higher and higher, and they do it by getting louder and louder. And by having that, that pulse is fast enough that it's causing forward motion and drive.
Somebody to love.
a physiological reaction. And they knew what they were doing. It's not like it's just a random thing. So yeah, we get this really, you know, if music is too boring, then we tend not to like it. If it's too far out, we tend not to like it. If it hits that sweet spot in the middle, we like it. So that variation and contrast is a good way to think about it. If something's too contrasting, we don't understand it. If it's the same all the time, we don't like it. But if there's a little bit of variation, so you can tie it into what you know, that seems to have the effect, or that seems to affect more people than anything else. So while we're listening, this is all the stuff, and we've talked about this, that's going on. You've got the motor cortex causing your foot to tap, or maybe you want to dance. You know, in a lot of cultures, music and dance are the same word. They're not separate. It's the same thing in a lot of cultures. So for us to talk about music without dancing, we don't think about that, but other cultures are like, you guys are weird. They don't get it. So there's movement. You've got expectations in the prefrontal cortex, which is what generates the dopamine. You've got this part of your brain that's dealing with emotional reactions. We haven't even talked about that. Like bringing back memories, maybe. You know, can you remember the song that was popular when you went to prom or at your wedding? Or you hear that song and you go, oh man, it brings back all these great memories. Sound does that. Music does that more so than pictures or somebody talking about it. Music does it, smell does it too. Smell is the other one that's really powerful. Those are the two most powerful as far as generating emotions, which is pretty crazy. So this part of your brain is dealing emotionally, this part is dealing with it on a more intellectual level. Sensory cortex, if you're playing an instrument or singing, then you have a whole nother set of things happening because you're thinking about what's coming up. Am I fitting with everybody else? What am I going to do next? You know, as a trumpet player, I'm like, what's coming next? What am I doing? Where, you know, you've got all that stuff. You're remembering how to play the instrument. Then visual cortex gets added into it because I'm reading music that I'm playing and I'm watching the conductor, hopefully. And then the cerebellum, which is more of that movement stuff. So everything's happening. And so why did this develop? We're not necessarily 100% sure, but you know, there's a fairly popular theory that says language predates music. And a lot of people believe that. They tend to be linguists and more involved with words, but you can argue that it's actually, that's not the case. You make a good argument that music or something resembling music came before language. And the way you can think about that is if you think about, say, primates. When they communicate with each other, they're not using a language, but you know, if there's a chimp that's upset about something or is trying to warn someone, like, back off, you know, these low grunts. But then they have higher, softer sounds that they use if there's something a little more gentle. And there are other species that do that as well. And you can kind of relate that to musical ideas. That existed before, you know, before we learned how to say back off. So there are theories about that, you know. But looking at maybe things in a little bit different way as far as evolution, we have what's called binaural hearing. So each of our ears hears stuff, hears different things. Then one of the things that auditory cortex does is put that together. And we can determine location. And we can do that really, really well. And here's an example of what's happening. So imagine you stretch a pillowcase tightly across the opening of a bucket. Different people throw ping pong balls at it from different distances. Each person can throw as many ping pong balls as he likes and as often as he likes. Your job is to figure out, just by looking at how the pillowcase moves up and down, how many people there are, who they are, whether they're walking towards you, away from you, or standing still. That's what our brain is doing when we listen. And because if you close your eyes, if you take away the sense of sight, you can still determine where things are, how close they are, how far away they are, what direction they are.
And that's all from pressure pushing on your eardrum. There you go. So from an evolutionary standpoint, that's really important. If you're standing in the middle of the jungle and a tiger is coming at you, it's good to know where he is and how fast he's moving so that you can go the opposite direction. People that have hearing loss on one side or the other, to them, instead of hearing the world like this, they hear a world like this. Everything's all together. Now they use their eyes if they have sight to, you know, visual clues will help take care of that. But location is, we think, really the kind of the main reason that that hearing evolved to escape your, for prey to escape a hunter. So in addition to that, I talked a little bit earlier about that idea that different sounds affect us just innately. For example, you hear that sound, you're gonna look, where's that car? You're gonna use, that sound, we just know is a sound, I wanna get away from that. There's another one. Although that's probably more of a learned than an innate, but it's still, loud frequencies, sharp frequencies, high pitches tend to have more, be more warning signs for us. But then we'll end it with something maybe a little more comforting. Right, and then you can kind of imagine what it smells like. Think about that last time that you had. There you go. So, and that's not even within the realm of music, but it still can generate emotional responses. And so, think about a dog barking versus a cat purring. A dog bark is one of those alarming things. You're like, oh, but a cat purring is, unless you hate cats, it's not going to have the same effect on you. But again, composers know this. Composers are using all these ideas, especially in orchestral music, what we would call art music in general. It doesn't even have to be orchestra, but to give us these emotions. Okay, so we're going to move away from that for a little bit now and kind of talk about the health and wellness benefits of stuff that's happening. This woman, Jessica Grahn, is a researcher in cognitive neuropsychology as it relates to music and specifically rhythm. That's what she studies, is rhythm and how it works on our brain. And there's this little video clip I got of her talking about rhythm, and we'll go ahead and listen to that for a couple minutes.
It is a pleasure to be here today to talk to you about my research on musical rhythm and specifically why it is that music, but not other sounds in our environment, can compel us to tap or nod along, sometimes when we aren't even aware of it. To demonstrate this behavior, I have some 9-month-old twins who show us just how incredibly early it develops. Just very early in development, because it's universal across cultures and because it requires zero training, this suggests that movement may be fundamental to our capacity for music. And what is it in the music that makes us move? The key feature is rhythm. You can strip away the melody and the harmony and still get people's toes tapping with a simple drum beat. This is what I try to understand in my research. Is our brain's movement or motor system intrinsic to our human capacity to perceive rhythm? To examine this, we use magnetic resonance imaging machines to measure brain activity while people are listening to rhythm, but not actually moving along to it. What we find is a whole network of brain areas respond to rhythm. Not surprisingly, we get auditory cortex or sound processing areas right next to the ears because people are listening to a sound. But all of the other areas that we see are part of the brain's motor system, including the supplementary and premotor areas and a core motor area deep within the brain called the basal ganglia. Now, we see these motor responses for everyone, regardless of whether they have musical training. But people often wonder, what about musicians? Do their hours of focused training lead them to have greater brain responses, or do they barely have to switch on their brains when they hear rhythms? And the answer is yes. Often musicians have more brain activity, but it's hard to interpret. That's because when musicians come out of the scanner, they're often wondering whether I'm going to sit them down and say, now, I know you've worked your whole life on your music, and everyone thinks you have a promising career ahead of you, but I have seen your brain activity, and I'm afraid you just don't have what it takes. So we don't know if the increase in brain activity that we see in musicians is related to their enhanced rhythm processing or because of all the extra cognitive resources they bring to make sure they do well on the task. Another thing people often ask me is, my partner has two left feet. They wouldn't know a steady beat if it hit them over the head. What is going on in their brains? This is an active area of research in our lab. We actually test people's ability to feel a beat by asking them to listen to music and tell us whether the beeps are on or off the beat. You can try this now. Now, if you said those beeps were off the beat, your brain activity might look like this. We see that people who tend to perform well in detecting the beat have more activity in their brain's motor areas. Now, this neuroimaging data suggests that indeed the motor system is very responsive to rhythm. However, it's possible that people are imagining moving to the rhythm, and that's what makes their motor systems light up. So to truly know if the motor system is key, we need a causal method. And brain stimulation gives us that method. Here, we run a very small 2 milliamp current through the brain to safely alter activity in the motor system. When we run the current one way, the brain area under the electrode is excited and the motor system neurons fire more easily. When we run the current the other way, they are inhibited and the motor system is suppressed. If the motor system is truly involved in our rhythm ability, we should see that people's performance on rhythm tests increases when we excite the motor system and decreases when we inhibit it. And that is indeed what we find. When we excite people's motor systems relative to no stimulation at all, we find that their performance on a rhythm task improves. And when we inhibit their brain's motor systems, we find that performance is worse. So if rhythm is so intrinsically tied to our motor system, can we use this power for good? Maybe to help increase or normalize motor system activity in those with movement disorders? This is a question we're investigating in my lab, where we focused on walking or gait, as gait is one of the most crucial activities we have for daily living. And we focused on a particular population that has difficulty walking, people with Parkinson's disease. Now, Parkinson's disease arises from dysfunctional activity in one of the key areas we saw light up earlier when people listen to rhythm, the basal ganglia. Patients may have trouble initiating movement, or they have slow speed or short steps. So what we want to see is if we can really improve that speed. To measure gait, we use a pressure-sensitive mat, which automatically measures their gait patterns without us having to attach any wires or anything else to them. What we want to know is what features of music enhance gait the most. And today I'll just touch on two that we've looked at. One is groove, by which we just mean, how much does this music make you want to move? High groove music is usually up-tempo with a clear beat. The other factor is enjoyment. Is this a song you love or one you hate? Now, here's one of our tireless participants, along with my former graduate student. Here, we find that groove actually makes a big difference to how quickly people moved. Listening to low groove music slowed them down compared to a silent baseline, represented as zero here on this graph, whereas high groove music actually sped them up. Enjoyment, however, doesn't make much difference. This suggests that somehow the music is getting into our motor systems whether we like it or not. In the future, we hope to be able to combine the approaches I've talked about here, using our understanding of how every individual's brain responds to rhythm, coupled with brain stimulation technology to enhance those responses, to further optimize outcomes for those patients that have movement problems. Thank you for listening.
So just one aspect of music that is pretty much all she looks at, and how does that work for us? And if you think about that idea of rhythm, anytime you have a group of people doing an activity, it works better if they're all basically on the same rhythm. So that's why you think about, there are lots of recordings of chain gangs in the South in the 30s and 40s. And there's one guy singing a song and everybody else is accompanying call and response. which just comes out of African-American musical traditions. And it's a way of staying safe. It's because everybody's moving at the same time and you don't have, you know, tools flying all around. Vikings, you know, you look at those old movies of Vikings and this guy pounding the drum, you know, and that kind of happened. You know, everybody's moving their oars at the same speed. That way it's going to send the boat in the right direction equally. It's not going to be moving all over the place. So work songs is one way that we're using rhythm to synchronize, and we've always done that. You know, and if you think about the most popular music in any culture around the world, it's usually music that is dance oriented, high rhythm music. That's part of how we're wired. You know, so rhythm is a big part of that. So some other medical benefits. Well, we already looked at that image, but one of the things they did is they did a study on patients who were about to undergo surgery, and they had their choice of listening to music or taking an anti-anxiety drug before the surgery. The patients who listened to music had less anxiety and lower cortisol, which is a stress hormone, than people that took the drugs. In one study, anyway. That's something they want to look at more. But the idea that listening to music that you like was able to calm you down and put you in a better kind of mental state for the surgery, wow, great. You're not spending a bunch of money on drugs that could end up mucking something up anyway. We're just able to do that ourselves. And so, you know, dopamine that we talked about that gives us that excitable hit is used in different ways as well. It can be used to affect other functions in our body as well. And they found that, you know, you get not only lower stress hormones, but higher immunity levels can be, it's all part of, associated with immunoglobulin A is what seems to be boosted by music. And so that affects immunity. Higher counts of cells that fight germs and bacteria. So these are things that we're learning about now when we're trying to figure out how to use the brain to do that. Now with dementia, with Alzheimer's, for a while they thought that there might be some breakthroughs that we were going to have as far as how that works. And it turns out that most of what they've discovered is that no, music has no effect on, especially on late stages, it's not going to be any kind of a cure, but in early stages, it can have a strong effect on sundowning. And so if the caregiver is noticing that this is happening, if they're starting to, you know, kind of drift away, if they give them music, especially music of their childhood, that seems to make it helps. There's the sundowning is not as pronounced. They don't get as agitated, and they tend to be calmer when they add photographs that kind of can trigger with the music. It triggers memories in some of these people. Again, in early stages, there are some, apparently we're finding some benefits with performing music as well as listening to it. So music therapists are starting to include that as well. So there are... there are some benefits that we're finding in treating some types of dementia through music, which again, that's great. If you can improve the person's quality of life, even for a short time, that's going to be a benefit. You're not giving them drugs. You're not, you know, it's something that our brains are still able to do. And an interesting statistic that I came across just the other day, there was a study in 2021 that found that lifelong music making seems to make one 55 to 65% less, or gives you a 55 to 65% less chance of developing mild cognitive impairment or dementia. They're not quite sure why. They're still trying to figure out it. And again, these are, you know, they do a study and they find something out. They're like, oh, well, let's replicate it. Let's do other studies and see if this is going to stand up or not. So a lot of this stuff is still in the early stages, only 2 or 3 years worth of research. So we're still going, but Yeah, so there are medical benefits to this. Now, there was one more thing I wanted to talk about as far as music in our brain, and that's the idea of an earworm. You guys know what that is? An earworm.
It's a song that won't get out of your head.
When you get that little chunk of a song stuck in your brain and you can't get rid of it. I apologize in advance for this, but I'll give you a couple examples and then we can talk about how to get rid of them. So what we've decided, through research, we found that earworms tend to be faster in tempo. You don't get a lot of slow earworms, or most people don't anyway. The structure of the piece is very simple, very repetitive. We think why it sticks in your brain is because you can't put an ending to the song. So if you can't remember all of the song, your brain just keeps looping through that part that it knows to try and come up with an ending. We know a little bit about it, we're still learning about it. But anyway, a couple of examples. One is relatively recent. Simple, short, repetitive. And in this case, it repeats and then it kind of moves on, but it never really resolves. And that'll just get stuck. It's like, oh, okay. So that's a more recent one. An earlier example, although this is one that if you have kids or grandkids, right? Because that song literally never ends. You go through mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, cousins, nephews, you know, ex-wife's hairdresser. It just keeps going and going and going. And again, it doesn't really have a resolution. The resolution, as far as harmonically, is when it starts up again. So, yeah, that's, and probably the one that has the worst reputation is this one. One of the reasons for that is because if you're on the ride, It's a Small World at Disneyland, that's all you hear for like 15 minutes during the ride. So it's just, and it's got two parts to that song, and it just goes back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth. And there is no ending to that song either. So that's why we think this stuff gets all stuck in there. So how do you get rid of it? Well, you find the song, you listen to it, you hear the ending, and that may be enough for your brain. Get it. It's like, okay, we have closure, we can move on. Another thing is find another song that will wipe that one out.
And get stuck on another.
Well, it may or may not. For me, oddly enough, I don't know why this is the case, Beer Barrel Polka. I start thinking Beer Barrel Polka, whatever stuck in my head is gone, and then I finish Beer Barrel Polka and it's gone too, and it's done. I have no idea why that is. If you're a musician, some people have had success by actually playing it or singing it. And again, I think it's that idea of completion. Some people have it so bad that they have to use anti-anxiety drugs. I mean, it can be really horrible. That's sort of the downside of music, is you get those things stuck in your head that even if it's a song you like, after a while. So anyway, what I'm going to leave you with is one of the songs that I really enjoy and doesn't get stuck in my head, and hopefully if there's anything in yours now, this will clear it out as well. But our brain deals with music is really pretty amazing, and composers are great at understanding how this works all the way through our brain, and not only is it affecting us on a purely physical level, but also on an emotional level and an intellectual level. And our, as far as we can tell, our brains are the only ones that do that. Our brains are the only ones that are advanced enough to have gotten to that point. That makes sense. So it's really kind of a fascinating area. The more you learn about it, the more interesting it gets. There are a couple of books if you are interested in learning
more about it. You can tell from all my notes in them that there's just all this fascinating stuff. One is by Daniel Levitin, who's another cognitive neuropsychologist. His lab is up in Montreal at McGill University. He wrote this book called This Is Your Brain on Music, and it talks about some of the same stuff I've talked about that goes into all sorts of great detail. And then there's another one called Music, the Brain, and Ecstasy that's also a really interesting read about how our brains work and how it affects us. So yeah, if you're interested in stuff, those are great books to look at. But anyway, there you have it. So just a little bit about music in the brain. So yeah.
Back to the Chopin. That you did. When you played that the first time slower.
Yeah.
To me, it was more chaotic.
Yes.
Yeah,
it would be. Yeah.
Whereas I think when it's sped up, when it's played at that tempo, at the proper tempo, your brain doesn't hear the dissonance or whatever is there.
Well, it hears it, but part of it is because it's not lasting as long.
Right.
And it fits within the context of what's going on. And so those cross rhythms that you were hearing, that's a big part of Chopin's music. He does stuff like that all the time. And like you said, when it's taken up the tempo, that flow is there. So that example was kind of more to sort of demonstrate how we hear little pieces and put them together. Because you would never hear it that slow. Unless you were sitting next to somebody, some little kid learning how to play it, you know. But yeah.
And the other thing, when you talk about rhythm and chain gangs, if you go to YouTube, and it used to be that the rails would be out of alignment.
Right.
And you'd have, there's black people out there, and there's a guy, he was a champ, they were straight in the track out.
Yeah.
And you go to another spot where the track was crooked again, and they get that.
Right, because everybody has to move it at the same time. Yeah.
Just to get them in the same movement.
Yeah. And there's also, if you had guys on either side of the track with picks hammering the spikes in, they're alternating back and forth. And if you weren't in sync and the other guy comes, you're either going to get your arm broken or your head bashed in, or it would kill you out there. So yeah, it's just out of necessity. But the other thing that it does is it passes the time. You know,
so
you're doing hard labor for 8 hours. Well, this is a way to, not think about that solely. To help you focus on something else, which again kind of goes back to that idea of during surgery and anything like that, where if you take your mind off it, you don't get so anxious about what's about to happen. And, it is really helpful that way, just on a purely kind of medical side of things. Yeah.
I have issues with balance and gait, and I'm just wondering after all this, if it would be wise for me to.
Good. Go talk to Brett Linus. See what he has to say about it down at the physical therapy place. Oh, there you go. Yeah. Yeah. And, yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Right. And I could never do that because I would focus too much on the music. And I would be thinking about that, and then for me, if everything wasn't exactly the same tempo, then I would start freaking out about it. So I'm better off not listening to music or at least when I did run. But that's being a musician too, I think, because it works well for pretty much everybody else.
But you also have that safety issue, like you're paying attention to what's in your ears.
True.
Walking, maybe
true.
That's not
well, as long as the music isn't super loud, that's that's the thing. But if you're like on a treadmill or something where that's a stable surface and the rock isn't going to come jumping up or whatever, it's a really cool treadmill. But it would be a good
think about to try that and see if that helps.
It doesn't have to have music with words in it. A lot of people now aren't really good with words like that. So they just have instrumental music that keeps their beat in it.
Right. And that's essentially what you're listening to anyway, is the drums and the bass and the pulse is what helps with that. Yeah. Yes. And actually, well, instrumental music, I start thinking about even more. So, actually, one of the things, I guess we didn't mention it, but talking about adding words to music, and so when your brain's processing everything, just everything that's sound, then when you add words to it, then that adds a whole nother level. And a great example that I always think of is a lot of Randy Newman's music. If you know him, he's got a song called Political Science. And the music is this great, boom, chuck, kind of French dance hall, can-can-ish sort of fun, danceable music. And the lyrics are about how the rest of the world hates the United States. So let's just bomb them all because they don't like us anyway. And then we'll just take over the world and we'll save Australia because we don't want to hurt the kangaroos. But, we'll have kimonos that we can wear and Italian shoes. It'll be great. And so you listen to that and you go, oh, well, okay. This is sarcasm. So what you're hearing instrumentally reinforces the absurdity of what he's talking about. However, when it was written, it was during a time, when the Cold War was at its peak, and I knew growing up in Wyoming, I knew a lot of people that was kind of their attitude. Like, nuke the rest of the world, we don't give a shit. We're better off without them. So there were people that buy into that, but when you listen, the reason he's not serious is because the lightness and the danceability of the music underneath of it. It's not real martial, oh, let's go kill everybody. It's let's go kill everybody. And so you start, that adds a whole another layer to what's going on. You hope pick it up. He's really good at that, at writing these kind of character songs that give you information in the music that explains what he's talking about. And not him, I mean a lot of, the whole idea of art song, which was, music for piano and voice, where the piano is an equal role. The piano is telling a story. Schubert and Schumann, and there were a lot of these guys in the Romantic era that are writing these that the piano part foreshadows or reinforces what's going on or lets you know kind of the mental state of the person singing and they're just brilliant at it. Again, it's composers know what they're doing and they know how to manipulate us pretty well. Movie music is a great example of that.
Movie music,
that's
funny. People are picking on it.
Well, and that's the weird thing about it though, is because if movie music is doing its job, you're not really aware of it. It's just reinforcing the overall effect. So if you walk out of a movie and you go, I don't really remember much about the music, probably, and you like the movie, it probably did its job very well. With exceptions, Bond movies are a great exception. Because the James Bond theme, you hear that and you know what's going on. Star Wars, So sometimes the music does help, but other times, horror movies are a good example. Because, there's somebody walking down the hallway and the creepy music's playing, you're like, oh, don't do it. And they get down to the end, and then the guy jumps out and stabs them, whatever. But if you listen to that without music, it's like, oh, a person's walking down the hallway, oh, they got stabbed, huh? You're not musically invested. For the most part, there are a couple movies that don't have music. Paranormal Activity was one that had no music in it because it was essentially a documentary or a mock documentary. And so, Bernard Herrmann wrote the soundtracks to those, and so there was music in there.
But he said that he liked silence as the most scary thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, because your imagination starts to take off. That's for sure. But Psycho's a great example though. The shower scene would be nothing
without that violin.
Yeah. Yeah. And so It definitely has an effect, but yeah, sometimes stuff can be scary without. But I think we've gotten so used to that. If you watch a movie that doesn't have a lot of music in it, something's not right. You know, it just doesn't seem right because it's just become so much a part of what we do. Oh, okay. I got to get out of here because I have to go to a rehearsal. So thanks, everybody.
We have to get out here.
Well, thank you. You need to go out and have dinner. I'll give a little shameless plug for the Black Hills Symphony is playing Saturday night. It's the first concert of the season. It's in the Performing Arts Center in Rapid, and it's all kind of Halloween themed. So some scary music and some kind of interesting stuff. So it should be a good concert.
We're getting History 9 tomorrow.
History 9 tomorrow. At noon.
Yeah,
100th anniversary or 100th birthday of the library, and so we're going to have a panel talking about the history of the library. Richard's got some slides set up to show us, and I think Julie's going to be here, who else is going to be here? Julie's going to be here.
Somebody said one of Carol's.
Yeah, one of Carol's daughters is coming up for it, so she can tell some stories about Carol. Oh, is Reed doing it?
I don't know.
I don't remember. No, Reed is not going to be.
No, I think she said no.
But
they asked her to.
I got the list just
laid. Anyway, so it'll be, that'll be kind of interesting and fun. So,
Julie and then Jeannie is a Shine, Francie Roberts.
Oh, yeah, Francie's talking.
Davis, Kingsbury, Dorothy Pulcher, and Kelly Mecklenburg.
Oh, right, Dorothy,
I'm not going to be on the panel. But I
would
be here.
I'll be here, but
you can and jump in, and if you have anything to say it. It's all good.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sam. We'll see you guys. Let's see you next
time.